Okay, well, welcome to episode 7 of the Edgar Rice Burroughs podcast. I am Tim DeForest. I'm the author of several books on old-time radio, pulp magazines, classic comic strips, and other related subjects like pre-digital pop culture. With me today are...
Jess, Terrell, you would know me from the Edgar Rice Burroughs Facebook discussion group entitled For the Love of All Things Edgar Rice Burroughs, where Lilla Pop and I and a group of over 3,400 members talk Burroughs every day, 7 days a week.
And I'm Scott Stewart. Do a lot of freelancing writing, a lot of editing, and enjoy the chance to get together with you guys here.
Okay, and today we're going to be talking not directly about one of Edgar Rice Burroughs' books, but about a movie based on his most famous character, Tarzan of the Apes. And we're going to be talking about Tarzan and the Valley of Gold, starring Mike Henry as Tarzan. And this was it was produced, I believe, in 1965 and released in 1966. Am I remembering that correctly?
Yes.
It's one of three films in which Mike Henry played the Ape Man. It's a really a fun movie. It's one of my favorite Tarzan movies. I hadn't seen it in years before I watched it again in preparation for this podcast. I'd forgotten how much fun it is. And I enjoy Mike Henry as the Ape Man. I think he does a really good Tarzan. The supporting cast is great, and it's a really just entertaining movie on several different levels. And we're going to be analyzing it tonight on the podcast. And Jess, you had done some research on the production history of this that you sent us. Did you want to go through that?
Oh, I would love to. Thank you for asking. I have three aspects I want to examine this film from. First of all, take a look at the prior history of Tarzan films and how they had evolved over time. And then a look at the cast and how that was put together. And then the timeline for the production of the movie, because there are some interesting stories here, and I'll get to them eventually, depending on how long-winded I am. So going back to the Weissmuller era, that was from 1932 to 1948. There were 12 Tarzan movies starring Johnny Weissmuller. Many of us first found those on Saturday afternoon reruns. The last of those films was made in Mexico, for what that's worth. That was followed by five movies with Lex Barker from 1949 to 1953. Then we get into the Gordon Scott era. There was six films, if my math is correct, featuring Gordon Scott, beginning with Tarzan's Hidden Jungle in 1955. There was no Jane in this film, no mention of Jane. And that becomes significant here as we move through this this history. This film, Tarzan's Hidden Jungle, was produced by Saul Lesser, and the producer here is also significant. 1957 saw Tarzan, The Lost Safari. Now, this, with Gordon Scott, this movie was significant because it moved Tarzan closer to Burroughs' definition. That is, he was somewhat articulate, and that he could carry on complete sentences and had some education beyond just his jungle know-how. It was directed by Saul Lesser. Jane does not appear. And for trivia buffs, there is a mention of Opar. However, it is a native village, nothing particularly impressive. Not like the Lost City that we're all familiar with in the books. Now, 1958 saw two events. Again, with Gordon Scott, there was Tarzan the Trappers, produced by Saul Lesser. Jane was there, played by Eve Brent. And this was really intended for a television series that was never picked up. It was eventually released as a TV movie in 1966. So that was Tarzan and the Trappers. But back to the theater, Tarzan's Fight for Life, again with Gordon Scott, 1958, produced by Saul Lesser, and Jane, played by Eve Brent. Now, what is viewed, I think, by film historians as The breakthrough movie for Tarzan becoming more articulate and literate was Tarzan's Greatest Adventure, again with Gordon Scott, 1959. The producer here has changed now, Cy Weintraub, and there's no Jane. Then 1960, the last Gordon Scott film, Tarzan the Magnificent, produced by Cy Weintraub, and no Jane.
Yeah, and if I could mention just briefly, it's obvious that Jane doesn't exist, not that she's just not mentioned, but that she doesn't exist, because in Tarzan's Greatest Adventure, I reviewed that on my blog recently, he has some romantic interlude with the girl he's rescued in that one, which he would never do if Jane were around. He was a completely faithful guy. I think it's obvious that they've left Jane out of this version of Tarzan completely. Because in a lot of the books, sometimes Jane wasn't just mentioned. Tarzan was off having an adventure, and Jane wasn't involved. But in these later Gordon Scott movies, it's pretty clear that Jane simply does not exist in this version of Tarzan's universe.
Well, that's a very great point, because the presence of Jane, even though Tarzan and Jane was one of the great literary love stories, the presence of Jane long-term posed some challenges for Burroughs in developing these adventures, because he could not do... Tarzan was an honorable person. Burroughs was one of the honorable heroes, so Tarzan just could not do romance with Jane around. Certainly, it is, I think, pretty well documented that Burroughs intended or came very close to killing Jane off at the end of Tarzan Untamed, but had a change of mind. There was, I understand, an outcry from fans, perhaps an outcry from family, saying, don't do away with her. So at the end of Tarzan Untamed, in the book version, Tarzan, one of the last things there, one of the last events, is that Tarzan finds out that Jane's still alive. Mm-hmm. But obviously it does pose some challenges in trying to build romance into a story, because that can be enticing. It's also an addition to an adventure. Oftentimes Burroughs would resort to having another couple play out the romantic angle of the story while Tarzan fought the bad guys, found the treasure, and saved the world. Mm-hmm. All right, moving on now back to our history. We had already discussed the Gordon Scott films. We've established that Tarzan was gradually becoming more articulate and literate. And apparently the movie makers did not want to spring a super intelligent Tarzan on the movie goers, even though some of those movie goers who have read the book saying, where's our intelligent Tarzan? All right, moving now to the Jock Mahoney era, that's two films, 1962 and 1963. The 62 film is Tarzan Goes to India, produced by Cy Weintraub, no Jane. And Tarzan's Three Challenges, 1963, again produced by Cy Weintraub, no Jane. So Cy Weintraub had produced now four previous Tarzan movies, those two Jock Mahoney's and the last two of the Gordon Scott that preceded them, gradually making the movie character more articulate, beginning with Gordon Scott. For the next, Weintraub wanted a reasonably believable situation, a young Burt Lancaster to take over the Tarzan role, and action someplace in the world where Tarzan has not been filmed. Now, he compromised on that a little bit, and that's why I mentioned Mexico earlier. Mm-hmm. And there was an intention, I think, pretty clearly to broaden the audience, to entice women to enjoy the films, hence the possibility of some romance, and to ride the James Bond bandwagon. And if you're unaware, spy movies on both television and in the theater were everywhere in those days. There was The Man from U.N.C.L.E., there was Get Smart, there was the Flint series with James Coburn, there was the Matt Helm series with Dean Martin. Even Hitchcock got involved in espionage and intrigue and spy tales. Of course, this was spurred on by the Cold War, the space race, and Vietnam. Just named three things where we were trying to keep up with the Russians, and they were trying to keep up with us. Now, let me take a note here. That's my history section. Let me take a note here that this material is coming from two sources. I love my Burroughs reference books. I highly recommend reaching back here to the reference shelf. Tarzan the Movies by Gabe Esso, soft cover book. You can sometimes find it on eBay, published by Citadel Press, out of Secaucus, New Jersey. And then, of course, the other superb reference is the coffee table book, which is a little heavier as I reach again back to the reference shelf. Tarzan on Film by Scott Tracy Griffin. A beautiful coffee table book. Leave it out on your table. Display it with pride. And with friends and sit around and watch a fine Tarzan movie when they can't themselves and want to know more about it. Mm-hmm. All right. Now, take a closer look at the characters, main characters. Tarzan and Valley of Gold. I think I've got everybody here. And the search for this Burt Lancaster type. Weintraub interviewed some 300 to 400 candidates, including Don Bragg, who was an Olympian, and the great Frank Gifford from the New York Giants.
I didn't know that. God, I'm having fun picturing Frank Gifford as Tarzan now.
Well, if Kathy Lee in any of this, I'm not sure where she was in those days. I didn't research.
Jane.
He decided on, Weintraub decided, of course, on Mike Henry, L.A. Rams linebacker, 6'3", 220 pounds, described as a steamroller chiseled by the hands of Michelangelo. That's a direct quote from our reference books. His rugged good looks was reminiscent of Hal Foster's comic strip Tarzan. You put the two side by side, it was pretty close. Henry was in the NFL for 7 years with the Rams and Steelers, had some brief acting experience that probably helped him get the job. Before filming, though, despite his magnificent condition, he was asked to lose 20 pounds from his legs and waist. I don't have any before or after pictures. Well, we have the after pictures, of course, in the movie, but I don't have any before pictures, but that was the direction. Our villain for this movie is Augustus Vanero, played by David Opatshu, who started in Yiddish theater, had several prior appearances. Of course, as a Star Trek fan, I know him as a non-seven in the Star Trek original series.
Yeah, that's actually what the name I think of whenever I see him in anything. And he was one of those character actors that seemed to be in every TV show at least once. And every time I see him, it's, that's a non-seven. That's my default name for him.
Oh, I totally agree. I do that as well. His resume is impressive and long. And I was so tempted to read through all of them because you know how long-winded I can be. But
yeah. Well, just by chance, I saw him in a Time Tunnel episode I watched a couple of weeks ago. So if you like old television, you'll randomly run into him quite often. He was one of those hardworking character actors who was in TV in the 50s and 60s.
He had a suspicious look about him with that beard, which is somewhat of a rarity in those days, or mm-hmm. maybe a exotic might be right one. The beard, the eyes, the look, his voice, he could fall into the villain role and handle it very convincingly. Scott, did I hear you say something?
I was just agreeing that you can see him in many of the shows, especially from the mid-60s, early 70s.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Our villain's henchman is named Mr. Train. I don't have a first name for him. Played by Don McGowan, who is 6'6" and 230 pounds, at one time played football for USC. The young fellow who is, shall we say, the object in many ways of this film, Manuel Padilla Jr. Of course, we also know him from the Ron Ely Tarzan show. His performance was so good, he was invited to be in the next film and also to be a regular on the TV show. Now, some trivia here. Sharon Tate, who was a very attractive actress, was initially signed for the project. There are some promo pictures of she and Mike Henry and probably Major, the Lion, that we can find that are available on the web. But she was pulled from the project by her manager, who said she was destined for great things. And also, sad to say, but in the interest of complete reporting, Mrs. Tate would pass away some 4 years later at the hands of the man family. It was August 8th through 9, 1969. So a sad note there, but felt I should mention that. Mm-hmm. Sharon Tate was, but that was, again, 4 years after Tarzan and Valley of Gold. So the character of Sophia Renault that was to be played by Sharon Tate was instead played by actress Nancy Kovac. Again, Jane does not appear in this movie, mm-hmm. but in the book, and it is mentioned, I thought I had the page number here, I don't have it from me, but, I do, page 48. In the book, Tarzan does pause to remember Jane. She's home managing the Greystoke Estate. She shuns the bright lights. The book does mention both the Kaburu drug and the witch doctor treatment of the Tarzan head, but Jane is off taking care of the homestead.
Yeah, one of the things, we'll talk about the book in depth after we finish the movie, but one of the things I did enjoy about it was all the references to the original book to tie it more closely into that than the movie did.
I'm a big fan of references and footnotes, and that book does make good.
Another note I'd like to make when we're talking about the movie history, I can't let this pass, is the actor who played Mr. Train also appeared in the creature outfit in The Creature Walks Among Us, the last Creature from Black Lagoon
That is a great point. That slipped my mind, but you're exactly right.
Yeah. There's also with Nancy Kovac, there's another Star Trek connection. She was in the episode of Private Little War, a brunette in that one, as opposed to being a blonde.
Ah, yes, that's right. Good points. Mm-hmm. The script was written by Claire Huffaker, who was an accomplished writer of both scripts and novels himself, sometimes adapting his own novels for use on movies. The novel, of course, was by Fritz Leiber. And the first chapter, which we'll discuss later on, of that novel was his audition to do the novelization for the movie. Mm-hmm. So that's a look at the characters. Now, about the movie development, moving on to my third, this is an Excel spreadsheet, by the way, for anybody. Moving on to the timeline for the movie development, I found some interest here. January 25, 1965, and much of this info comes from the Gay Bessos book. The other info also comes from Scott Tracy Griffin's Tarzan on Film. So the working name for the movie was Tarzan 65. Filming began in Acapulco. In fact, we'll get to this in a moment, but as the movie starts, you see some scenes of a city, a grand city, with water skiing and such, and that's Acapulco, I'm pretty sure. Filmed entirely on location in Mexico near Acapulco, Mexico City's Plaza de Torres at the Capitol Tepic Castle. And, the Tahuacan ruins and the caves at Guerrero on location, all beautiful scenery. The shootout that Tarzan has is in Mexico City's Plaza de Torres, which I mentioned a moment ago. Of course, you know, Jane, we've talked about this. Personal note, I first saw this movie probably right, I've done some checking on the time frames, probably right after I had found the Ron Ely, Return of Tarzan paperback by Ballantyne with the Ron Ely cover, which got me hooked on the Tarzan books. I was already well acquainted with the Tarzan movies, but I recall anticipating this movie. It was billed as Tarzan versus the Modern Weapons of Warfare. And really adored this movie. A quote from Gabe Esso's book, Tarzan became a well-mannered, soft-spoken gentleman ape who was at home in a Parisian nightclub as in the treetops. He was hip to the modern world, could do the watusi at the better discotheques, and got the girl to him because he was a new embodiment of culture. In Valley of Gold, the movie, he lost his savageness. We never hear the Tarzan yell in that movie. Christmas 1965, Valley of Gold. I had some questions on the release date. I've got different dates on that. It was intended for a release in Christmas 1965, although that was delayed. And they were on a super aggressive schedule, trying to do three movies and a TV show in the time frame of much less than 2 years.
I know that Mike Henry eventually sued the producers over the working conditions and the amount of physical hardship he went through.
Good.
Including the chip bite, too.
Yeah, including getting bit in the chin by that darn monkey. Yeah.
Well, there was an instance, and this is on the Gabe Esso Tarzan of the Movies, page 179. During filming, and this is on the next movie, which is Tarzan and the Great River. They were in Brazil filming that one. During filming in a downtown Rio park, the lion, who's in that film also, although I think he had a different name, Major gets away racing through the city streets. Pedestrians scramble, and Mike Henry in his Tarzan gear, which means a loincloth and bare feet, runs after Major and brings him back. No harm came of it. But Major, of course, was a wild animal, even though he had training. He would later bite a native on the foot during filming. And Henry would say, and this is a direct quote, "These animals were unpredictable. It was dangerous working with them because none of the big cats had been detoothed or declawed. Wild animals can never be tamed or trusted." And while we all, I'm sure, love seeing a good animal in a good lion or whatever in a Tarzan movie, there certainly is some level of danger there. Mm-hmm. Oh, in the second week of shooting, again, this is on the next film, Tarzan and the Great River, Dinky the Chimp, and you all referred to this, bit Henry on the chin, requiring 20 stitches. Henry was down for 3 days with monkey fever delirium and took 3 weeks to recuperate. I wanted to include all this because in discussing Tarzan and the Valley of Gold, Mike Henry's difficulties with the animals and the working conditions usually comes up, as it's been mentioned in my group several times. One more footnote here. Co-star Jan Murray, again on Tarzan the Great River, objected when he was told to jump in the water with crocodiles. He was assured the crocodiles were trained. But he went in, no harm came of it, but obviously there was some risk there. All right, that's the timeline that I wanted to cover. Oh, on the release dates, I started to get into this. According to the SO book, Tarzan Valley Go was released June 1966. According to Internet Movie Database, it was July 1966. And according to Tarzan on Film, it was September 14, 1966. Now, if indeed it was September 14, 1966, that's about a week after the Ron Ely show premiered, which would make some sense to me. Mm-hmm. I distinctly recall sitting in the movie theater, but that movie theater I was in as a child was so far back in the sticks that they ran roughly a year behind all the movie theaters in the big city. I just recall seeing it. So that's all in my Excel spreadsheet and the timeline and the history and the backstory.
Sorry. I wanted to mention something about Claire Huffaker, the screenplay writer, who was a superb writer. I just wanted to recommend his Western Badman, which he later adapted the screenplay for the John Wayne movie War Wagon. And he is a superb novelist, and his Westerns especially are well worth finding and reading.
I'm glad you mentioned that. War Wagon is certainly one of my favorite John Wayne movies and favorite Westerns. That's a great point. Mm-hmm. So moving now into a discussion of the film, Tarzan and the Valley of Gold, it opens up on screen. One of the first things you see is a multicolored symbol that I suspect is supposed to suggest Aztec culture. I could not find the exact symbol during my brief search, but I think that's where that's coming from. Then scenes in the movie in filtered color rapidly flash with the music. If you're familiar with the movie already, and I've been through it several times, you can recognize scenes as they come up. And also, I'm a music buff, so I will note that the theme music, which has never been released on record to my knowledge, is light, sophisticated, upbeat, thriving bossa nova Latino jazz featuring brass, piano, percussion, marimbas, congas, drums, with intermittent animal sounds, composed and conducted by Van Alexander. It's reminiscent of the work of, who was also popular in the mid-60s, Herb Albert, Sergio Mendez, and the Julius Welcher Baja Marimba Band. Got stuck on band there.
And it was good music, too. It really sets up the ambiance of this being kind of a spy movie as well as a Tarzan movie, I think.
Indeed. And I think it refers back to that quote I offered earlier about Tarzan being able to conduct himself adequately in a discotheque. Mm-hmm.
Very, very cosmopolitan as opposed to a wilderness. Mm-hmm.
That's an excellent word right there, cosmopolitan. That's what they were depicted. Refined, educated. Under control, soft-spoken, again, no Tarzan yell. And throughout this entire film, Mike Henry rarely raises his voice. So he's in control. In my book, that's Tarzan in control because, well, he's Tarzan. Mm-hmm. We discussed earlier the scenes of Acapulco in the opening of the film. And in the movie, Binero, who's sitting probably at a hotel, watches Tarzan land in a helicopter. Mr. Crane, of course, is standing there at attention, always ready for action. Music continues until that helicopter touches down. Tarzan exits. He's picked up in a Jeep. You notice, you don't really know he's Tarzan if you're watching this for the first time. He's in a business suit, briefcase, no hint that this is the ape man, in fact. Venero has trained, notify someone that Tarzan has arrived. Tarzan boards a connecting flight, possibly to Mexico City. And we also see a cutaway. We see that Antonio, who is supposed to pick Tarzan up, is shot in the parking lot, and he's replaced by an imposter. One of the shooters poses as Antonio. But Tarzan doesn't know this, although the viewer does. So this imitation Antonio has picked up Tarzan. They're driving through Mexico City in a convertible, and Tarzan, being Tarzan, even though he's wearing a business suit and carrying a briefcase, asks about the smell of blood in the car. And Antonio knows nothing about this. He says most people wouldn't notice such a thing. Mm-hmm. So that is possibly the first hint that this is Tarzan that we're seeing here.
Yeah, and it's a great touch too. That's exactly the sort of thing Tarzan would notice.
Indeed it is. Antonio says that they're going to see a professor who wants to show Tarzan something in the bullfight arena. Well, as they drive into the bullfighting stadium, it gets more and more peculiar because they go in through this gigantic opening, which is obviously used for service equipment, let's say, perhaps delivery vehicles, and they drive right into the center of the bullfighting ring. They drive all the way into the arena floor. Antonio pulls a gun on Tarzan. Tarzan overcomes him, but there's a sniper in the stands who fires at Tarzan. So Antonio's out of action, but Tarzan's got this sniper he's dealing with. Tarzan opens the trunk, presumably to block the view. He retrieves the pistol, and the stadium's empty except for the sniper. But Tarzan is pinned down in front of the car. Tarzan retrieves a broken mirror in the dirt, uses it to blind the sniper, and then he runs to the wall, and there's two walls there, an inner wall and an outer wall. He's pinned against the outer wall, and the sniper is a lousy shot and misses him, a clear shot at him, probably still feeling the effects of the mirror reflection he was blinded with. The sniper misses him, then Tarzan vaults over the wall. Tarzan runs into the stadium, up the stairs, that's just like doing stairs in the football practice days, and approaches the sniper from behind, locates, and you see a couple things there. You see I think it's Corona beer sign, very ornate, and a gigantic Coke bottle. Now, the sniper is looking out over the stadium, has his back to Tarzan, does not see Tarzan. Tarzan makes use of this gigantic Coke bottle, shoves it over, it rolls down the stadium seats, and takes the sniper with it, kills him.
I was going to say, I don't know if they did product placement back then, because he runs by a bunch of Coke signs on the pillars too. That's probably the best endorsement for Coke either ever. You know, when Tarzan wants to kill a villain, he doesn't use Pepsi; he uses Coke.
You're right. You go better. You're right about the product placement. Some companies weren't quite aware of that power in those days, but they could very easily have been the case.
Yeah, and I don't know if they had to get legal permission. I'm sure a lot of the Coke signs were just there on location and got into the shot. So I have no idea if they had to get legal permission to show from Coke in those days or not. So.
Right. That's a great point. Mm-hmm. So Tarzan goes, we next see him speaking with Professor Talmadge, whom Antonio was supposed to take him over to see. Let me note here that the Internet Movie Database credits refer to Inspector Talmadge, played by Eduardo Noriego. It's actually Professor Talmadge, so IMDb is incorrect. They should say Professor Talmadge, not Inspector Talmadge. There is a police officer there, and he's making notes and listening to all this story unwind. Professor Talmadge tells Tarzan of Vanero, and shows him a photograph of Vanero and Train. Tarzan does not know them. Tarzan is not aware of them. Then the professor shows a watch. He cautions Tarzan not to touch it. They go outside and set the watch off. It explodes. This Vanero makes use of explosives in nice-looking packages, I might add. And Tarzan responds, this is what he sends to his victims. What does he do when he's really mad? So this whole thing, and Tarzan is really not even clear as to why he's been asked to come over here to investigate this. Now, he knows Ruiz, who asked him to come. They're good friends, and we'll meet Ruiz here in just a moment. But Tarzan hasn't made it to Ruiz's compound yet. He's speaking to this professor and this police officer about the incident he had at the stadium. So the professor, Talmadge, explains that this whole thing started about a month ago when a little boy walks out of the jungle. I'll skip that. The child was wearing a solid gold amulet that attracted Monero's attention. And it had, of course, conveniently has a map on it. The boy eventually escaped to Ruiz's place. And this child is believed to be from Tucumã, which is rumored to have a bad treasure. There's vague legends there. Vanaro expects to find a city of solid gold. In the book, Ruiz acquires animals for zoos and is a longtime friend of Tarzan. The movie does not explain any of that. Tarzan must be okay with acquisition of animals for zoos. But that's just an observation by my point. So the next morning, go ahead.
Oh, I think they mentioned later that Ruiz and Tarzan captured Major the Lion together in Africa. So they later on have a line to establish they had a friendship earlier.
That's a good point. Yes, that does come up. So the next, so this Tarzan spends the night, and then the next morning, this Inspector Talmadge, I beg your pardon, Professor Talmadge, that police officer and Tarzan ride horses out to Ruiz's house. But before they arrive, we see Ruiz and the boy, and Ruiz has been out someplace, and he's returning home, and the child greets him, and they go in the house. At the same time, they're on Ruiz's house, they're in the yard in front of the house, men with pack animals arrive and open fire, killing everyone, and they kidnap the child. They kill Ruiz, and, well, they shoot him, and they set the house afire. A dinky of the chip witnesses it all, but he's not telling anybody. Tarzan, the professor, and the policeman arrive very shortly afterwards on horses to find the dead bodies amid the smoldering remains. Ruiz is still hanging on to life. His last words to Tarzan tells of three of Anero's men who attacked them, took Ramel, the child, into the jungle. And Tarzan says, "We'll fly you to the hospital." Ruiz says, "You're always a bad liar," and then he dies. So they have some acquaintance with each other, as you said. So the policeman says he's seen enough. He now has enough evidence to arrest Venero. The policeman says, so Tarzan's obviously planning to take some kind of action. The policeman says to Tarzan, "What do you need?" And here's a great line. I love this line. Tarzan says, "A good rope, a hunting knife, and a soft piece of leather." So Tarzan reintroduces himself to Major the Lion, Dinky the Chimp. Of course, it's established that the Major is a man-eater, and Tarzan is explaining how dangerous he is while he's standing there, you know, kneeling there with his hand inside the cage. The professor asks Tarzan for an explanation, says, "What do you plan to do?" Tarzan says, "You wouldn't understand if I told you." Classic comeback that doesn't tell you anything. It only whets the appetite of the viewer. So after a moment's delay, Tarzan appears barefoot in loincloth. Outfit is casual but practical, he says. He declines help from anyone. And they ask, "Exactly how are you going to accomplish this?" He's going after the boy. "How are you going to accomplish this?" Tarzan says, another classic line, "Here's my scout," pointing to Dinky. "Here's my guide," pointing to the leopard. "And here's my army," pointing to Major. Tarzan releases Bianco, the leopard, from the cage and speaks with him. And then he speaks with him, he calms the animal, and then he releases it, telling him to go find your master. Bianco scampers off. Tarzan releases Major, telling him to follow Bianco, so he gallops off. Tarzan gathers up Dinky and the rope and then runs after them. At the Venero Mansion, some business associates arrive. It's a very elaborate mansion with antiques, marble, very expensive, very nice, not the place to set off explosions. We'll get to that in a moment. Captain Voss is there to collect money for his payment for moving supplies, heavy equipment to the middle of nowhere in the jungle. Venero excuses himself for cigarettes, goes to his office, lights two cigarettes, and withdraws a small package, placing a burning cigarette on one of them. Venero asks Voss to his office, and in the office they discuss the money owed. Venero offers a ring to Voss, who takes it reluctantly, and then he exits the office, goes back upstairs, and meanwhile, the blonde, who find out more about her shortly, wants to leave. He won't let her, and the bomb in his office explodes. And that's probably the point where I'm supposed to hand the baton over to you. Is that correct?
Yeah. So I think I would agree the movie does a really great job of introducing Tarzan as Tarzan in that scene in the compound where he changes into the loincloth. He has his line about all I need is the hunting knife and the rope, and changes into his loincloth and just says, you know, "I've got the animals. I don't need your troops. I'm going after the kid alone." It's just it's one of the best Tarzan moments in movies. This is Tarzan. That's who Tarzan's supposed to be. I love that part.
I think it stands out for his transformation, too. To me, it makes me think of Clark Kent becoming Superman, mm-hmm. traditionally in the phone booth. There's such a dramatic change there. It's like, okay, here we are. Now we're really getting to business.
Yeah, because we saw him handle himself well against the bad guys in the arena, but he was still in a suit, and he's been in just normal clothes till then. So having him come out as Tarzan, determined to go into the jungle with just his jungle weapons, is just awesome. And I think Mike Henry carries it off. You believe that he can do this. He's going up against guys with machine guns, but you don't doubt that he can take them. He had a good presence for Tarzan. He pulled the character off very well, I thought. So what happens at this point in the film is that Venero has gotten a small army together, armed with surplus World War II weapons and a half track and a tank of World War II vintage, that he's going to use the pendant he got from Rommel that has a map to the city to get to the city. He's had Rommel kidnapped. I don't know if the movie explained it completely well. I think he wanted Rommel as a backup in case the map didn't get him exactly to the cave entrance to the city, so which is why he was having him kidnapped rather than just killed outright. But he's got that pendant, so he's fairly confident he can find the lost city. And they start off through the jungle. Unlike the book, there's no explanation for how they get extra gasoline for these vehicles. I honestly didn't think of that until I read the book, and the author of the book explained it, or changed things slightly to have a fuel truck going with them.
In the movie, they should have had a truck with them for the troops to ride on, instead of making guys walk the time.
Yeah, they were all walking too. But Venero's, I don't think Venero is that good on like human resources for his employees. One thing I wanted to mention, I'm sorry, I'm going to backtrack a little, about Mr. Train. He obviously, his appearance and his demeanor remind me of Oddjob, the villain henchman from Goldfinger, the James Bond film. And I think that was deliberate. I think they deliberately did Mr. Train in a way as a shout out to a famous Bond henchman in order to once again capture that spy movie ambiance they were trying to go for.
I meant to go back and look at the timeline for the James Bond films and slip my mind.
Yeah, Goldfinger was a couple of years before, so it had been out by then. So I think it could have been a deliberate shout out or deliberate homage or just a deliberate steal from Oddjob for Train's appearance and silent demeanor. Did he speak in the movie at all? He's quite articulate in the book, but in the movie he didn't have much dialogue. Venero's got his small army, and as a side note, his tank is a Stewart tank. As a side note, I love that because as a kid, one of my favorite comics was DC Comics' Haunted Tank, which featured a Stewart tank. And just seeing one in the movie was kind of a thrill for me, just on a completely personal basis.
Great.
Now, he's staying in radio contact with the three guys who had kidnapped Rommel. But Tarzan catches up with them, along with his animals. He ambushes them at night. Things don't go completely smoothly. The main bad guy is carrying a 30-caliber machine gun. He manages to shoot and kill the leopard before he's taken down. But all three bad guys are killed. The boy, Rommel, is rescued. There's some very nice scenes there where the boy is mourning the leopard, who was his friend. And he's also mourning Ruiz and the people who were killed back there. And Tarzan sympathizes with him. He talks it out with him. He encourages him. And you immediately establish a really effective father-son bond, a bond between Tarzan and Rommel. And it's believable and done really well. And the child actor playing Rommel, he was, you know, as he did with Jai, he plays that sort of role really well. And so that's another strength of the movie. Was the kid's not just there to be rescued. He has this, a father-son or mentor-student relationship going on with Tarzan that they established very effectively right away. Tarzan gets the radio. He tries to pretend to be one of the bad guys when he's talking to Venero, Venero is a totally evil, rotten person, but he's also smart, and he picks up on that. Tarzan has a great line where he just cuts it off. No, that was later on. I'm jumping ahead there. So he sends a helicopter with some guys with machine guns in it after Tarzan. And there's a great action scene where Tarzan first tries to use the 30-caliber machine gun he had to shoot back at the helicopter. It's a neat part of the movie that he will use modern weapons if he has to. It's not his preference, but if the situation calls for it, he will use them. And because when that gun runs out of ammunition, he gets a couple of hand grenades and makes a bolo out of it and uses that to take down the helicopter. It's a wonderful scene. For the video version of this podcast, if I'm able to edit it on, I will start the podcast with that, with showing you all that scene before we go into the podcast itself.
I think it also shows the trueness of the character.
Mm-hmm.
When ERB originally had Tarzan learning or finding the knife in the first book and realizing this gives him an advantage mm-hmm. over the other creatures, other animals. So, you know, we go a lot into a lot of times into the noble savage of Tarzan, but his brain work was smart too. He wasn't one to throw away an opportunity to be the victor, not by cheating, but an obvious advantage.
Yeah,
you'd be fool not to take it.
Yeah, Tarzan the Untamed, for instance, with fighting Germans in World War I and on the African battlefield, he used a machine gun and hand grenades and a sniper rifle, I believe, at one point. So he would use weapons when it was called for.
Very hungry.
Yeah. So anyway, moving on with the movie, Rommel and Tarzan and Major the Lion and Dinky the Chip are still trying to get to the city before Venero and his men to warn them. They find the girl, Sophia, who's been cast out by Venero. And you find out at this point in the movie, I believe we didn't know before then, that Sophia was helped Rommel escape from Venero originally. So we immediately have sympathy for her for that and for the fact that she has an explosive necklace that'll go off if she moves too much. And Tarzan risks his life to get that necklace off of her, and she becomes a part of the group. They continue on to the cave entrance that leads into where the lost city is. And Scott, is your voice up to taking over from here? This was going to be your part. Whoop, Scott, are you there?
Sorry, I had to stop. Wait for a second.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay,
I'm
sorry.
Did I miss there?
No, oh no! I've just gotten to the part where the Tarzan and his group have gotten to the caves, into the entrance. You were going to take over at that part point.
Yes.
I was going to ask you if your voice feels up to it.
Yeah. And the comments on here would be a little brief too, because there are some comparisons I want to make to the book when we get there too.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. When they go in the movie, the Tarzan, it's Tarzan and Sophia, and how you pronounce the boy's name there. No, I'm sorry, that's from the Tarzan series.
Yeah, Rommel in this case.
Rommel, yeah. And they actually don't take a real long time in the cave there. One of the things I would have liked would have had them travel a little more through a cave and maybe find some other interesting things on there. But they do hear that the bad guys are behind them and starting to try and find their way in the cave. The entrance being too small, they're going to have to do some blasting to get the vehicles through into it. So Tarzan sends the other two on their way and proceeds to ambush some of the scouts, some of the other henchmen that are coming through at that time, and try and slow them down. One scene I think is kind of neat, and it's smaller than in the book, but where he takes and shoots down the stalactites from the ceiling takes out a couple of henchmen that way before he goes on out.
Yeah,
into the
yeah. He had, I believe he had ambushed a soldier and taken away his automatic rifle. It was a Browning automatic rifle, and uses that to shoot the stalagmites down on the bad guys.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And, you know, when he attacked that, I think that was the very first one who came through that he caught.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of like the way, and this isn't about being bloodthirsty or anything like that, it wasn't like he did, snapped his neck or did a karate chop mm-hmm. or jumped on from behind. He had his knife ready, and he jumped up, and he brought the guy down into the ground to put the knife, you know, full thrust into him with his whole weight and stuff. It was a little more believable about how if you're going to take some out, you try and do it force in an ambush like that, as opposed to a great big fight. His goal was to do it as fast and as quickly and as quietly as he could at that point. Mm-hmm.
And it also shows that, you know, Tarzan is a good guy and he doesn't kill unless he's forced to, but if he does have to, he will do so very efficiently and without batting an eye.
Yes, exactly. So they have a few fights there in the cave like that, but then he goes out into the valley. I kind of wish they had made it a bigger thing when he sees the actual city. But we'll get to that part when we talk a little bit about the book. The boy and Sophia have gone ahead and they've warned the people about it. My understanding is they used local people who lived in or around the pyramids down there at that site to be the extras, the villagers there. Because it's not a huge crowd, but I think they had about 100 or 200 there, maybe. And there he meets the chieftain, or the chief of the tribe, who the people are, I guess one word would be, that'd probably be used in the 60s or now, enlightened. They're pacifists. They choose not to fight, and they believe anything they give in goodwill to avoid violence will sate the appetite of those who may be coming, which, of course, we find out is not the truth. Venero is a true, not just a sociopath, I believe a psychopath. He seems to enjoy death and the instruments of death. Mm-hmm. And so Tarzan does have a view of the valley, and they give him a little tour. And then the chief wants peace. And by doing this, he locks, tricks both Tarzan and Sophia into a cell so they cannot interfere when the other soldiers and the villains come, because he thinks he can work with them one-on-one in that way. Of course, he finds out that they have no scruples about hurting or killing anyone to prove their point that they want what they want. And in the course of that, they will also lose warriors that way too. The chief realizes he can't work well with these, with the men this way, and Tarzan does get out, get to be free and to help. But meantime, they have put a huge amount of gold out in front of the vehicles, the tanks and the jeeps, so they could take these away. However, Venero figures out that there's still some extra gold, that the chief hasn't given them everything. He wants that gold. So the chief takes him up to the room, takes him through a weapons room. I think what they call that, the unused weapons room or missing,
yeah. Broken. They were full of weapons, yeah. Old muskets and bows and arrows that had been broken.
A broken weapons room. And the Venero sees that door with the a solid gold door. And one part in the movie that kind of, I had a little bit of problem on this one, is he steps through and he closes the door behind him to get a closer look. Well, I know the guy is a little psychotic and off edge. I think he'd be paranoid enough he would not close the door and allow himself to be trapped in the room, which of course is what happens. He pulls out a gold head peg out of the wall, which opens up a like gold dust, gold that sifts, comes out of the ceiling and buries him alive in it. Meantime, Tarzan ends up taking over another tank and firing on some of the vehicles while they're leaving. And they fire back, and poor Dinky the chimp, I still want to call him, I don't want to call him Dinky, I want to call him Cheetah.
Cheetah, I know.
Gets wounded in the battle, so Tarzan does step out to help Cheetah get away, and so he can be mended. And, of course, Mr. Train, at this point, you could call it a blood feud or whatever. He has heard a lot about Tarzan. He tracks down Tarzan. Of course, his boss is missing. He needs to find it. And he and Tarzan get into a, it's not a wild, over-the-top fight. In fact, it's very much like an athletic fight. Mm-hmm. You know, they talked earlier about Mr. Train being able to be one of three men who could kill people, jabbing his fingers into somebody, stabbing him in the chest or body. And whether or not Tarzan truly knew that part, he uses a great ploy by getting behind him, basically doing like a half Nelson or whatever behind him, so he cannot use his arms or legs in any way. Of course, he can match him in strength and proceeds to take him down and break his neck in that fight. The other villagers, meantime, have come out, parts of the tribe come out, and either chased away or taken out the other people who were taking the gold. And Tarzan and Ramel and Sophia get together with the chief, and it's all, you know, Tarzan, they win the day. So that's really good. And he will leave the animals with Ramel, so he'll have them there, the lion and the chimpanzee there. And then in the movie, in the case of the movie, then Tarzan and Sophia leave and go back through the cavern. And the last thing he does is blows up the entrance to the cavern, hoping that no one will discover this village and bother them again until so-called outside world can be as civilized as the ancient hidden village and Valley of Gold is inside.
Mm-hmm. There's one thing about this latter part of the movie that I think is interesting, because the movie is obviously made has escapism and works really well at that. It's just a good adventure story. But there is kind of some interesting philosophy to that. When the chief of the tribe is a complete pacifist and is even willing to give up all the gold to avoid a fight and discovers that doesn't work, the hero is still willing to kill people regardless. And in the end, he admits that sometimes you do have to fight back. And he himself led Venero to his death, which I agree was a little contrived. Venero should have known something was up when he went into that room all by himself. But
I like the idea of him being buried by his greed, though.
Yeah,
like
that was buried in gold dust was a great death for him. But it explores the philosophy of, is total pacifism right or even moral if it allows evil people to run rampant? And there's some thoughtfulness to that bit of the movie.
If I could, I'd like to kind of wrap in a couple of notes about the book at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And then we could kind of work backwards from there. But a couple of things I thought is in the book. Lieber does it. I think he did a really nice job of following in Burroughs' footsteps in writing this book. Overall, I enjoy it a lot. Mm-hmm. But there are many more characters who do come in the book, because he's fleshed out different characters and plot lines and circumstances, situations that come up. So those play a bigger part in the end final. But last chapter of the book has everyone sitting around actually dining and talking with each other, and sort of a fare thee well to my fellow traveler type scene. I'm going to call it a Last Supper thing, but being able to look back and see how they're victorious and what's going to come of the future. And I really liked the way he handled it. I thought it was really good. It didn't just, he does have the cave get blown up at the end, but I thought it was a really nice thing. But earlier we were talking at the very beginning, touching a little bit about Jane. And there's a line in there, unless I've misread it in the last chapter, where another lady asked Sophia, after Tarzan has thanked everyone, being very gracious about he didn't win the day, everyone did it, and the important parts they did that helped him save his own life, and mentions about Sophia and her acrobatic abilities in escaping and fighting. And there's a lady there who turns to her and says, you're in love with him, aren't you? And she goes, but he has a wife in London. And so I'm thinking that's a reference to Jane right there. So she's not part of the story, but it gives that anchor about relationship there. Mm-hmm. And he's true to her. And this lady who was the mistress of the villain, has really come full circle to realize, you're just talking about your take on the world and the ethics and morals, can pacifism sometimes be a bad thing? And she was just kind of along with the ride on this before realizing she helped Ramel escape and stuff, that somewhere in this world you have to step up and take a stand for who others are and who you are.
Mm-hmm.
Also, like, he gave a description of Valley, saying it's about 5 miles long and 2 miles wide. But in today, if they made this movie, they'd have to do like Kong Island. There'd have to be something so satellites or things flying overhead wouldn't discover it. You know, 100 years ago, you could have a mountain range that kept a lot of people apart. But even in the 60s, well, obviously they found their way in it, but planes flying over and stuff, that place won't be hidden for too much longer.
No, there's not much room for lost valleys and lost cities anymore, sadly. So, yeah. Jess, did you have anything to say about the movie's finale?
I was going to say a couple things. I felt that the climax there with Vanero's demise in the treasure room was poetic justice. It reminded me of a scene that we would see in more recent times from Game of Thrones, where I think it's Venerys Targaryen is wanting a gold crown. So the Dothraki leader, played by Jason Momoa, gives him a gold crown, which pours molten gold over his head, brings his death.
Yeah, ironic ends to villains are always satisfying, I think.
Indeed.
Quicksand or being buried alive, any of those are good.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and anything else, Jess, about the ending?
Oh, I have to say, also thinking about more recent films, lever that Vanero pulled in that treasure room, which started at the gold pouring from the ceiling, was not unlike a hazard that Indiana Jones might run into.
Yes.
Jones could find his way out of them.
Yeah, of course, in the several of the Indiana Jones movies, the villains meet their end by getting what they want, by looking in the Lost Ark or confronting the aliens in the Crystal Skull. So the villains get what they want, like Vanero did, but it kills them because they can't handle it for whatever various reasons. So
also wanted to comment on the scenery in this film. I recall the very first time I saw this movie. I remember it well, and I've watched it many, many times since then. And I'm just so taken with and this is a real life area. But I was just so taken with the buildings and the pyramid-like structures. I wrote down here in my notes. Now this is what a lost city should look like.
Mm-hmm.
I also
enjoyed those caves. And I wanted to note for our listeners that no caves were harmed in the filming.
I found a great way, if someone wanted to do another book or in the future, tie into this too.
Oh.
You remember one of the tunnels where Rommel said something about that's the tunnel or the path to Kubay? And he goes, what's that? He says, that's the place where nobody comes out of, like the place where everyone's dead. He goes, it's so deep, it may even go to the middle of the earth. Now, that sounds like a great adventure to me.
Tarzan could say, I've been there. So.
Yeah. What a wonderful idea. Mm-hmm. What a wonderful idea.
Yeah. The location the location in Mexico where they filmed this, where it was all those pyramids, it was a perfect setting for a lost city. I was a little surprised when Vanero first gets there. He fires off a tank shell that blows up on top of one of the pyramids and kills some people. I was surprised they let them set off even a fake explosion on top of what must be a thousands of years old pyramids. But I guess they got permission to do that.
Yeah, so, they had a five day filming permit there.
Okay.
They were very, very regulated on what they could do, although that doesn't mean they couldn't pass off a little money to the local.
And that reminds me, though, on that note, it was in my notes, and I meant to cover it in my opening comments, but somehow I skipped it. You're right, there was a 5 day arrangement. They even asked for an extension on that 5 day arrangement, and they were denied it. Now, some local, my notes are not in front of me, so bear with me. But some local writer raised a fuss saying that the American film crew was desecrating the monuments there, that ancient site. So the Mexican government had already made agreement to allow the filming there, and the Cy Weintraub and his people had already paid their money. They were allowed to film it. But the government wanted to review the film when they were done. So Weintraub turned the film over. They spent a day or so reviewing it, said it was fine. There was no problem. They saw no problem. So, again, to your point about the explosion is a very good point. They must have figured out some way to rig that to look better than what it actually was. But the Mexican government was okay with it and said that this rider who raised a fuss really had nothing to complain about.
But
Weintraub was still put off by all of this, and also he had wanted to do some filming there. I did force him to do a little filming either in studio or another location that he really wanted to do on location, and he said he wouldn't go back to Mexico again, which is almost was shot in Brazil.
Okay. You know, that explosion on top of one of the pyramids, now that I think about it, it's possible that they set off something behind the pyramids and just use perspective to make it look like it was on top.
So it produced more smoke than actual damage.
Yeah. So, but it was an effective looking, in terms of story purpose, it showed the chief that he couldn't just pay off Venero with gold, that his people were going to get killed no matter what. So it was a very effective scene.
Well, and Tarzan's impassioned plea during his discussion after that, to evacuate the city, I thought was also a very good move. Mm-hmm. And a warning came a little late for those people on top.
There really is a thematic meaning to the film, in that, you know, sometimes you have pacifism is great, but sometimes you have to confront evil or innocent people are going to get killed. And there's some depth to this movie that I think is really worth mentioning. So,
my dad told me when I was a kid, sometimes you run into bully problems, and he said, you have problems with the same bullies unless you finally take a day and you might get hurt, but if they get hurt, they probably won't bother you again. Mm-hmm. There's a lot to that.
There is truth to that. And also there is another indication of Tarzan's willingness to use modern weapons when the situation calls for it, because he does take out the driver of the tank and then use the tank cannon to kill most of the bad guys. So he's got his knife and he's got his rope, but if he can use a 37-millimeter cannon and that's what's called for, then by golly, he'll do so. So
we did get to see that cannon shooting off a few rounds. That's true.
Mm-hmm.
And I was also thinking about those guys going in there, going gold hunting like that without a truck, as we commented earlier. It was like going to Walmart without.
Yeah, I think most movies, I think this movie included, cheat a little on how much gold weighs when gold is a part of the movie, because all the gold they put on that half track, I don't think even an armored half track could have moved. They must have had tons, but and whatever they were using for props wouldn't have weighed as much. And obviously they weren't worried about what gold would weigh in real life. They just wanted to move the story along. I think the most famous example of that is Kelly's Heroes, where the World War II soldiers are stealing gold from the Nazis, and they completely ignore how much the weight of all that gold would be when they load it into a truck at the end. But there's some times where you just want to move the story along and you don't worry about details.
Right.
Yeah.
By the way, I found one of my notes. It was on page 240 in the book where Tarzan does reflect on his dislike of the use of guns or explosives. He's familiar with both, knows how to use them. He just doesn't actually care to use them for killing. But obviously, in both books and movies, he does what he needs to do to get the job done.
Mm-hmm.
But I was glad to see that reference in the book.
Yeah. Okay, any more comments on the movie itself before we move on to talking about the novelization?
I kind of wish, touched on this earlier, that they'd spent done a little bit more with the caverns. And when they came out, and I agree with what Jess had said, if you got an ancient city, it's not always diamonds and spires of gold and overwhelming stuff like you see in a lot of fantasy movies and kingdoms. But I kind of wish they would have given it that sort of like awe aspect when Tarzan's, you know, seen so many things, Opar and stuff. But just for the audience coming in, that, you know, come in low and see these, you know, ancient pyramids and the temples and areas there, and kind of grazed over it just a little bit to feel like this is. I know when I was a kid and saw the movie in the theater, like 1966, 67, whenever it came out, hit my backwater town. I thought it was great, but maybe seen few too many special effects and other things. Yeah. But it just seems sort of like everyone happens, you know, Sophia, and well, we don't see her reaction. Tarzan comes out, and the men coming to hunt, steal the gold, they come through. It's just like, oh, just another lost city and another day in her life.
Yeah, for Tarzan, finding a lost city is called Tuesday. Okay, well, anyway, there was a novelization done by Fritz Leiber, who is a superb and very well-known in science fiction and fantasy writer. His sword and sorcery tales about the two characters Fafford and the Grey Mouser are brilliant and funny and exciting, and if anybody listening who hasn't read the Fafford and Grey Mouser stories needs to find them and read them right away. They're wonderful. And he was a Edgar Rice Burroughs fan. And I think you guys know more about this because you mentioned something I didn't know. The novel takes about 60 pages to get to where the movie starts. And so that, I didn't know that that was an audition that he wrote, that whole sequence that he incorporated into the novel.
They liked it so much, I asked them to keep it and make it part of the novel.
Okay.
Even though they didn't have it in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I would submit that first chapter provides some insight for those who are unaware. Of course, they're hoping to expand the fan base here. Some insight for those who are unaware as to Tarzan, who he is, and his character, and what he's about. Because here, he refuses to kill.
Mm-hmm.
He values life. And he sometimes values animals more than he values people.
Mm-hmm.
Their behavior and whatever their principles are.
Yeah.
And that comes forth in this first chapter, which is so well done.
It does very well establish Tarzan as he was, as an Edgar Rice Burroughs Tarzan. My copy of the book actually has the number 25 on the spine, which means they were trying to market it as the 25th official Tarzan book to make it canon.
Yeah, got the number too.
Yeah, so, but...
That's the only edition of this book as of right now. There has been some talk about being included in the reprint project that Burroughs Inc. is working on, but nothing official on that.
Okay, that would be great to have it available again. It is a worthwhile novel. I will say right off, because I want to say mostly good things about it, so I will give my one criticism here, is that Leiber adds a lot of background to the characters and the Lost City and all of this, and mostly, and it's all well-written, great stuff, but I think it affects the pacing of the story a little. I think there are times, it's like, 317 pages? I think it should have been 40 to 50 pages shorter and paced a little quicker. I think a lot of the additional background information was good in and of itself, but didn't serve the novel overall. It made things, it slowed the pacing of it down a little too much for me. I don't know if you guys thought the same thing, but I think it's a great novel, but it's less than perfect because it just sometimes gives you more detail than you need, and it slows the action down.
Well, I would respect.
Go ahead, Jess.
Excuse me. I would respectfully say otherwise. I eat detail for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and I loved every word. And again, I'm a big fan of references and footnotes.
Mm-hmm.
And his attempt to pull that back into existing Tarzan canon, I thought was just absolutely magnificent. I loved that when I first saw it, and I love that today in rereading this book.
Yeah, and I respect that opinion totally. And really what I'm saying is more of a nitpick than anything else, because I still did enjoy the novel enormously. By tying it into, he does mention Jane, establish Jane, whereas this movie, like all the other Cy Weintraub movies, pretty much ignores Jane. Now, in the movie, there's no romance between Tarzan and Sophia. She's just kind of there. So you had room in doing the novelization of putting references to Jane in easily without affecting anything in the story itself.
But at movie's end, they go together, so one is left to wonder, perhaps, of what happens off camera.
Well, that's true, too, yeah. So, and as Scott mentioned, the book does... make a point of saying that Sophia is in love with Tarzan, but she knows that nothing's going to happen because he's not going to cheat on Jane. And that's an important point. Tarzan always has to be faithful to Jane, or he's not Tarzan.
Exactly. And I will say, because it had been a while. I've read this book several times. We discuss it in my Burroughs discussion group for the love of all things Edgar Rice Burroughs. It comes up now and then. And I've certainly read pieces of it here and there in order to participate and be prepared for those discussions. But I will say, in preparation for this, I read through chapter one very closely, made some extensive notes. And you know, as a youngster, you hear about things and you see things on television, and everyone kind of thinks it's normal and no one raises any question. I recall some of the concerns that the professional boxing, for example, has encountered over recent years. And in reading through this, just using that as one example, not to pick on boxers, but in reading through this and the descriptions of the cruelty of bullfighting, mm-hmm. really got my attention this time, and made me wonder. It just showed, and I realize this is a honored profession that's gone on for hundreds of years in some countries, which is their privilege, but it also made me wonder about the cruelty of mankind and other people and animals, and then of course there's those fans in the stands screaming for blood who have absolutely no chance of being harmed themselves, at least not from what's going on down the ring. And yet they have the guts to sit there. So mankind did not look very, very good during that practice.
No, but I think it's interesting that Tarzan is participating in this bullfight because he's a good friend of one of the star bullfighters. So he himself does not approve, and he goes through the fight without hurting the bull. And that's all awesome, and I think it is perfectly in character with him. But he's not self-righteous or condemning towards his friend the bullfighter. They're obviously friends with each other, and they respect each other's viewpoints on this.
That's great. Tarzan still respects him and understands that perspective. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Yeah. Now, Mr. Train in this book is a lot more erudite than he is in the movie. He's got, he's got almost genius level conversations here, and he's increasingly self-aware of just how nuts his boss is too, as the story goes on. But it ends also with a physical confrontation with Tarzan, which he, in the book, he loses very, very quickly. But he's still an interesting character, and there is a case where Leiber takes time to flesh out a kind of a one-dimensional character in the movie into giving him more personality. And now that I said that aloud, I'm much less critical of Leiber for doing that than I was a few minutes ago, because some of those characterizations he adds are really quite good. Venero, for instance, he has this like religion of death. He literally worships death, which explains his psychosis to a lot. It makes him a very creepy villain.
Well, also when he offers Tarzan after Mr. Train is dead, mm-hmm. he's kind of like going to Tarzan and saying, "Hey, you could work for me. Look, I can give you stuff you don't have." I don't think he quite realizes what Tarzan already has, and Tarzan doesn't need it.
Yeah.
But you know, it's like, okay, hey, he's all about the power, mm-hmm. and working each other up, and just assumes everyone else will follow suit on that. The idea that he thinks Tarzan would step and work with him or work for him, mm-hmm. in that corruptness is a very interesting take in the book, to just show how far out he is.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it really troubled me. I was admiring Venero's house there, and I meant to go into this when we were going through the movie, about the wonderful furnishings in his house, very expensive marble floors and antiquities and rare artifacts. And there he sets off an explosion in his office, which, of course, he was pretty precise, so maybe he knew just exactly what it would destroy or wouldn't destroy. But that's told me how nuts he was.
Yeah. I just thought, does he have contractors on speed dial to come in and fix rooms when he blows people up in them? Because how often does he do that?
But it's also a power play, because it scares the living daylights out of everyone else there, that he would just go ahead and blow him up in his own house like that and say, okay, let's get on business. You're with me, right?
Yeah.
Yes, Venera's home. Another explosion just went off.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, this reminds me though of a subplot that was briefly touched on in that first chapter about a plane that went down in the desert in the States and was loaded with gold bullion, and all of that was missing, and it was implied very strongly that Venero was involved in that. And I think part of the purpose of that, now this is in the first chapter, it's not mentioned in the book, in the movie, not mentioned in the movie whatsoever. But I think part of the reason for that, get my microphone over here where I can be heard, part of the reason for that was just to show that Venero was a long time bad guy, villain, and was involved in a number of things, and possibly that each time he conquered something, each time he successfully pulled off a caper, a job, stole something, that just not only empowered him, but also he could use that to finance his next operation. It's not impossible that in that subplot of that down plane with the gold bullion in the Mojave Desert in the U.S., that what he recovered from that crash was used to buy his half track and his tank, mm-hmm. and his 20 or so armed troops that he was going to send down to this lost city in Mexico.
Yeah, and in fact, in the book, it was like 200 troops. It was a much larger column.
In the book.
Yeah. So, and I that sort of background, I agree, does add depth to the characters and verisimilitude to the overall story. Sophia too gets more characterization and gets to be more active in the climax than she does in the movie. In the movie, she's really mostly, I mean, we're told that she helped Ramal get away, and that's very much to her credit. But other than that, she really doesn't do a lot. She's kind of there just to have a pretty girl in the movie. So in the book, she gets to be a lot more active and plays a part in saving Tarzan's life in the final action scene. So the book does expand a lot on the characters, and I think Scott mentioned that it was Professor Talmadge and the cop with him, and they get reinforcements and follow Tarzan, so they show up at the end to take part in the final battle. So there's a lot more stuff going on in just terms of pure action in the finale than there was in the movie. And the action parts I have no problem with at all. Leiber does wonderful action scenes. So.
He did a really nice job on that, and I would put in too when you were talking about length. And I found myself just kind of sucked into reading it because he does write quite smoothly. Mm-hmm. But many of Burroughs' books do run in this paperback size, approximately 200 pages, give or take. So it shows he did put. Did not pad it, but he did put a lot more information in basing the story, and maybe like with the footnotes where he had referred to, you know, Tarzan and the Castaways or the Madman or whichever one, is a great jumping in place for people who may have read this book for the first time to get introduced to Tarzan on what books they might want to pick up and read.
Yeah, I did love the footnotes. Whenever he referred to one of his original adventures, there was a footnote there to tell you what it was. And that is that for new readers of Tarzan, that would have just been a wonderful resource.
It always bothered me that there was not a novelization for the next two movies, Great River and Jungle Boy, that Mike Henry was in. I really felt they deserved novelizations also.
Yeah.
I'm the guy that sees the movie, buys the book, buys the T-shirt, wears the I immerse myself in this kind of stuff.
Yeah, so it actually is surprising, unless there were legal issues. It's surprising there weren't more novelizations of these movies because it was so common before there was VCRs, before there was DVDs and streaming, and we could re-experience the movies whenever we wanted. Novelizations were the way you could visit it again after the movie had left the theater.
In comic books.
Yes. Yeah, comic book adaptations too. So they were so common for movies in all genres and TV shows in all genres. So it's really surprising, unless there were legal issues with the Burroughs estate at the time, that more Tarzan movies did not get novelized.
I think they should be the ones pushing for that kind of thing.
You would think. You would think there would be, and that there might have been legal issues is just a wild guess. I have no idea if that's true.
It may have been a time factor too, because they made those three movies within basically a 1-year time period. They shot them so quickly.
Oh yeah, but you had
to work that Fritz did on the book is so, it's so much far above what, when I think a novelization of a movie, when I see books on the newsstand,
yeah,
it's kind of like, it's just kind of like a page-by-page adaptation of screenplay. His book goes far beyond it. I think it's a respectable part of the Tarzan canon.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I agree totally. But you're right about the time frame that they were working under. It's amazing what they produced. In fact, I meant to mention this going through the chronology there, or the timeline early on. It said that they were scheduled to begin filming a TV show in February. Well, I went through that and timeline. I went through the timeline. That's one of the reasons I put it in the spreadsheet, was so I could see the step-by-step procedure there that they went through. And they said they were going to start filming in February. I never saw where they had any February where they could do filming on a TV show. But obviously, the TV show got done. Now, granted, with a different actor. But it was, this TV show was scheduled for September 1966. That's what they did.
Okay, well, cool. And that was a great TV show. The Ron Eli show is a favorite of mine. And as much as I like Mark Henry and his movies, I'm kind of glad he chose not to do the TV show, because I'm glad we got a Ron Ely Tarzan that we can enjoy on DVD nowadays, too. So
just put your hand and played it opposite of, like, Green the Hornet or whatever it was. Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. Also, one other thing I want to mention about the book is he did change some details, but he was sometimes working from the original script. That fight in the arena with the Coke bottle at the beginning, in the original script, that fight took place in a car wash. And yeah. Leiber uses that instead of the arena, and he does a really cool action scene with a more elaborate car chase that turns out really well. And in the book, the tank, it's a German Panther tank in the book, gets trapped inside a room in the temple. And that also apparently was something Leiber took from the original script that was sounds like it was probably too elaborate for them to be able to film.
They had the tank running up the steps too on a temple.
Yeah.
So with explosives in it.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of the stuff that happened in the book in the final action scene probably would have been too destructive to the pyramids in real life had they tried to film it.
Right. I'm glad you mentioned that car wash scene. That was well done, I thought. I'm glad you covered that.
Mm-hmm. So, okay, we have gone an hour and 25 minutes, so this has been a great discussion, but we probably ought to bring it to an end, or people are going to get sick of us. So next time we will be doing the novel At the Earth's Core. This was a listener request, and we appreciated getting a listener request. We love that. And when this is posted online or on Facebook, anyone who wants to request specific Burroughs works for the future, for future podcasts, please do not hesitate to do so. So next time was At the Earth's Core, the first novel of Pellucidor. Once to sign off, I'm Tim DeForest. You can find my books on Amazon.com, and my blog is Comics Radio and other cool comics, old time radio, and other cool stuff. Jess and Scott, is there anything you guys want to plug before we sign off?
Go ahead, Jess.
Yeah, go ahead, Jess. You first.
Very well. Thank you. Well, certainly my Facebook discussion group for the love of all things For the love of all things Edgar Rice Burroughs, with Lola Pop and all of our many members, come visit us and talk Burroughs with us. We're open 24/7. Love to talk Burroughs. Go ahead, Scott.
And Scott Stewart here. You can find hopefully new information soon on Random Eye Studio, Random Eye Comics on Facebook, our biggest project. And these two guys have been part of it. I'm hoping to get it rolled out onto the presses is Red Canals, which is, if you love anything connected with Mars, this would be the fanzine for you. So I'll leave it at that.
Okay. And so that's it for now. We will hopefully be back with another podcast soon. We appreciate all of you listening. Thank you very much.